It's a special event for us too, because you know, it's not every time that one turns 90, right? So it's mostly for the archives. So, but you know, you can tell them. So, yeah. Do we have some more people coming? Or
yeah, there's more people on the list.
There's
can
one
we have two more minutes of that?
Sure, at least one person is coming.
Okay, let's wait a couple more minutes. Okay.
I think this one's better because otherwise you'll have a shelf.
Okay.
You all have read it, right?
No. Yes. I read up on it.
That was the
deal. That's why I bought it.
Yeah, I read it, but I read it on a digital copy. Thank you.
I haven't read it. I haven't looked at it in a while.
Well, I think we're going to begin, and I really can't thank you enough for coming, because this is a project that I really believe very significant in the history of American literature. But before we begin, I want to.
Excuse me, I think.
Can you thank?
Speak a little louder.
Okay, yeah. No, can you hear me a little better?
Perfect.
Do you mean do I need
perfect
a microphone or
no?
Do I need a microphone? Let me begin by thanking the staff of the Grolier for the hard work trying to get this together. You know, that's Elizabeth and my wife Carol and Cassandra, a wonderful intern from Bennington, and then, you know, they've worked really hard. And also a special thanks to Francine, who has been helping us during this 90th year. She helped organize the event we had at the Auburn, and then coordinated a lot of things for us. So thank you, Carol and Elizabeth and Francine and Cassandra. And I thought before we begin, maybe we can, you know, introduce ourselves. I want you to be relaxed, you know. Relaxed, you know, this is Saturday late afternoon. You want to go see a movie or you have a drink of beer or something, but you're here. So let's see if we can say, you know, introduce ourselves casually, you know, friendly, and then we can talk. Okay.
My name is Jerry Bell.
Jerry Bell.
My name is Becca.
And Ellen.
Ellen.
Mona.
Mona. Phil.
My name is Anima.
Sarah.
Becky.
Diane.
I'm Andrew.
Anthony.
Megan.
Megan.
I'm Anne.
Carol.
Francine.
Elizabeth.
Herb.
Wendy.
Wendy.
Elizabeth.
Sandra.
James.
James.
And I'm Ben.
I'm Ben, okay. And that's Olivia there.
Olivia, yeah.
And Fanny Mankiti, the owner and proprietor of the bookstore. And my background is philosophy and also literature. I was born in Nigeria. I went to Pomona College where I did literature and philosophy, wrote a bachelor's thesis on Ezra Pound, came here to do my graduate work in philosophy. Yeah, so the title in itself, Citizen, the issues of political philosophy, and also the inbred, long brooding with the work that one did at the college level 60 years ago or more ago at Pomona, you know, the work I did on Ezra Pound. So for me, it's a convergence of the philosophy and the literature and the issues that are really important in national life. You know, the issues of governance, how we can make this place a better, this world a better place for all of us. So I think you all come from different perspectives, you have your dreams and your own worries about race, things that you want to say. And I really would love for you to be able to do this in a wonderful enabling environment, you know. Those people who are used to speaking more, I want you to speak and pull back a little bit. And those who are shy, I'd love for you to go at it. So please, what's going to be very useful and happy for all of us is at the end of the day, we can leave this place, you know, thinking and also feeling enriched that we've reached out to other hands, other minds, other folks. Okay, you already know about the Citizen book and the upcoming staging of the White Card. The collaboration between Emerson Arts and the American Repertoire Theater to get this important work, you know, on stage, the coming one. Citizen, of course, lays the groundwork for this. And the goals of the discussion, you know, is to get all of us thinking about the problematic of race, but also very importantly, the promise of race, okay? The promise of race. And now I'm going out on a limb and talking about the promise of race. But it all depends on the way we handle this. You know, we're not condemned to be at each other's throats, and that is also the point, I believe, this book. And so, to get us going, let me just read a couple of passages from the book so you can orient yourself and then I can open it up so you can all speak. Okay, 14. A friend argues that Americans battle between the historical self and the self-self. By this she means you mostly interact as friends with mutual interest, and for the most part, compatible personalities. However, sometimes your historical selves, her white self and your black self, or your white self and her black self, arrive with the full force of your American positioning. Then you are standing face to face in seconds that wipe the affable smiles right off your mouth. Mm. What did you say? Instantaneously, your attachment seems fragile, tenuous, subject to any transgressions of your historical self. And though your joint personal histories are supposed to save you from misunderstandings, they usually cause you to understand all too well what is meant. Second passage, the world is wrong. You can't put the past behind you. It's buried in you. is turn your flesh into its own cupboard. Not everything remembered is useful, but it all comes from the world to be stored in you. Who did what to whom on which day? Who said that? She said that. She said what? What did he just do? Did she really just say that? He said what? What did she do? Did I hear what I think I just heard? Did that just come out of my mouth? His mouth? Your mouth? Do you remember when you sighed? So this conflict or tension between the self-self and the historical self, the little achievements we have made that enable us, we feel joy out, that we are coming from different places, different racial backgrounds, even the man, the woman, American, European, Chinese, African, the good things that we've all managed to achieve. And yet then history hits you in the face. Have I been hallucinating? I thought something good was happening. I thought I knew her, I knew him. What just happened? History then takes away that smile from our faces, what happened? And then there's the little abrasions, you know. Did she really mean that? How do I take that? So, well, I think what we would like to do is to have people speak freely, see what brought them to this book, what really struck you as you read this book, you know. Maybe one can think about the way the Citizen book, you know, the privileged position of white Americans and how Rankin deals with this. Writer and says that the major objective in Claudia Rankine's work is exposing white invisibility. What do we mean by that? No. The idea that we don't see whiteness as a race, but that we see other races in relationship to whiteness. For example, in the theater, we might create a cast list that asks for two black actors, but we simply call for two actors without any qualifiers when we mean white actors. And then goes on to say that Rankin sees whiteness, quote, as an orientation towards the privileging of one race over another and creating an ideology that creates a benefit for one race over the other. All of these things intentional? Do they happen by default? The unintended consequences of prior societal action. Where are we? Where are we? Because if somebody stepped on your foot and it was an accident, you pat each other on the back, say it's okay. But if they meant it, it was intentional. Hey, so what do you mean? Ain't I a person? Why did you just do that? So the whole question of intentionality here, as we look at this problem of race and the way individuals react or respond to it, you know, how much of what we're dealing with has to do with these prior societal action, their unintended consequences, things that happen by default. And how much of it is intentional insult? We just want to poke you in the eyes and let you deal with it, son of a gun. So, as we look at these problems and the beauty of this, you know, I really think this is already successful to the white front. Look at all of us, white, black men, women, young, old. We've achieved, even before we did this discussion. Even before this evening is over, look at all of us here. This is what we want. Americans of different backgrounds, different colors, men, women, black, white, young, old. The achievement is already made in my mind. We need to listen. We need to listen. Open our minds, and we might be surprised at what we find. So I will pull back this thing and let you guys talk, identify yourself in one, you know, what your response to this book, what really grabbed you as you read Rankin's you know, Citizen, an American lyric. And at the end, we might also look at what it is that, you know, this has all got to do with literature. Politicians could be talking about this. People dealing with the national economy could also be talking about this, right? But it seems to me that race, as it brings all of us, good, bad, becomes the subject of literature, of poetry, of fiction. So its own impact or relationship to the literary production is something that we might look at towards the end. But first of all, you know, as you speak, what really struck you about this book, you know, this issue of microaggressions that people commit, you know, individual acts of racism, you know, the question of the relationship between the individual situation and the collective one, you know, the small acts that add up and the system, systemic injustice, you know, the you that is often addressed in this book, you. You, woman, you, man, you, white, you, black, you, citizen, neutral. I think the image and the cover of the book is also kind of interesting, too, because the 93 in the hood, and then Trayvon Martin in 2012. Okay, and then. The issue of violence, obviously. I will stop now, but I want to make a remark. You know, Susan B. Anthony, you know, the whole question of women's rights, Kelly Stanton, the issue of their not supporting, you know, the civil rights issue of black folk, black men, thinking that this really, how did they oppose the rights of, how does one deal with this in history when you try to write about the opposition, the stands against, because they wanted universal suffrage, right? So that the men, the women, the blacks can all be done together. And then you had a piece of legislation that was trying to rectify the historic injustice of slavery. And so it was really a man speaking, you know. First of all, it was the white man with the powers, and then the idea of getting the black folks, also the black men with powers. And then you have people who have been dealing with issues of women's rights, all of a sudden taking a stance in terms of that actual vote that, you know, no, you can't do that. The strategy being that we want everybody, okay? We want universal rights. So how do you now, looking back on this, think about it? Is that a case of racial insensitivity? Or was it a strategic decision that we're all in this boat together, we can't let these people have this thing because then the women's issue will be pushed aside forever. Let's go for the whole thing. So the opposition itself, if you can read the mind of the people, was it because they don't really care about the blacks, or was it because the matter of strategy they're saying, now, nah, look, let's do it all together. So these are issues of race in this country. How does one deal with that? These people that are respected, you know, in terms of their fight for women's rights, and so on and so forth. You know, how do you have a lens to go into their mind to see? But these problems arise because of the issues of race in the country. So anyway, let's see if you guys can kind of open up and speak, and I would love to hear your thoughts. I'm just one person reflecting on these things, you know.
Hi, I'm Becca. I know that I'm gonna be a little vulnerable here.
No, that's okay.
I know for me, the biggest thing I got out of the book is someone who really wants to be an ally in the fight for kind of racial justice. Like, I kind of looked internally and realized that there were kind of little things I did that may not have, like, I definitely have kind of like participated in microaggressions without even realizing it, and like I think this book really kind of forced me to look inward and realize, oh, I haven't been maybe the ally. I mean I definitely am not like a racist, but I definitely haven't been perfect in terms of like being an ally and being supportive. So anyway,
well, thank you very much for sharing, because I think, you know, the reflection and the sense of us being honest in terms of where we're coming from, you know, to deal with our vulnerabilities, the things we know we've been good at, even though other people may not understand, and also the thing we know we thought we're very good at, but look, you know, really I'm very shaky about it. And that's the sense of honesty. But I don't know if maybe some other people might want to speak up to this issue or something else.
I think I've been thinking about this issue all my life, which is longer than, it's been a long life. And I think one of the things that would make this it easier for us all as Americans or as people who are been educated Eurocentrically, which is, you know, the place where white supremacy gets its biggest push, is to decide that we're all racist, that we're all been tainted by white supremacy. And then it makes it possible for you to have conversations with people and to allow them to say the wrong thing and to make mistakes. At this point in my life, I don't expect any white person to be through and finished with their racism. It's been 500 years of this. And it's part of their culture. And so it seems that because black people have been so harmed, they feel that they can be made happy if they can find this one white person that is not racist. And will make them feel that if you can find one white person that's not racist, well, then you're going to be happy. And I think that's too much to put on your white friends. You know, to say, you know, you aren't going to have any kind of racism in you because you're my friend. You can say, well, you know, it's been 500 years of this, and you know, you come from a family full of white people, and they're all racist, probably, and some of them are not as racist as you are. Or, I mean, maybe they were more racist than you, but you don't have to make it up to me. You don't have to. That's my job. That's my job to say. So if I wouldn't be speaking to white people at all if they had to be my friend, they had to be
perfect.
So it's better to say, don't lie. And be honest, rather than to expect that they will have been through with all of the racism.
It's too much to put the burden on one, the shoulder of this person, to make up for all the historical injustices.
I mean, at the same time, they can be doing some work around it. It's not right for them to, I think, just to do no work, but to realize it's a process, it's an ongoing process. It may never get over in their lifetime. They don't have support from other white people most of the time, because whiteness means that you must stick together and be in the club. And I think the issue with ally issues is not the issue. The issue is in solidarity, because that means that you have been as harmed as I have by racism.
What's your name again?
Diane.
Yeah, Diane, yeah. So, I think I saw your hand over there. Okay, all right. I don't know, did you want to say something?
I mean, I just wanted to echo what Diane said, and especially emphasize that doesn't mean you can't do anything, because white supremacy and white culture is racist. But then just kind of accepting that is only the first step. Like, I especially liked what Rankine did with the sports metaphors and those examples, because I think that really kind of illuminates the ongoing landscape on which these kinds of conversations are happening, and the ways in which, even within that framework, where it's like one individual, maybe she's using Serena Williams in that, is the example I'm talking about, is able to kind of break through certain barriers, but that doesn't mean that there isn't a weighty history behind that, and that's not enough then to say, well, you know, I love Serena, so like that's the work of actually speaking against your relatives is important. So like just because you're friends with people of color, like, well, we can be friends with you, is not enough. Like you gotta call out your family, and you gotta call out your other friends.
One of the things that I found really interesting about this book, and I've not seen in any other book, is normally if you're reading a book or you're watching a show or whatever, character A speaks to character B responds. Well, in this case, it's really duality. You know, character A may be speaking to character B, but thinking about, you know, racial issues or other issues, you know, and if, you know, character A is black and character B is white, character A is thinking, okay, how am I supposed to respond to this? But what do I really think? You know, it's really very complicated, and one would hope, and we're not there, that, you know, each of the characters could speak with, you know, true truth. But there's a lot of, you know, what should I be saying, what should I not be saying, how do I react to this situation where I think maybe there are characterizations about me that are not true because this person doesn't really know me, you know, they're, and that I found fascinating. You know, life, it's just, the social interaction is very complicated, and you, one wishes one could get to the point where one speaks truthfully, and that's often not the case. And then it's you know, you have assumptions where, you know, one character is assuming something about the other. They don't really get to know that person. They're just kind of, you know, these assumptions, and you don't go deeper than that. And that's really difficult because you can't really get to know that person, which is what you should try to do.
You know, the issue of misunderstanding. I want to speak, I want to do this, but I don't also want to be misunderstood. I don't want to make it worse by coming across awkwardly and then adding more fuel to the fire rather than, you know.
The question of being understood, I think, is really something this, reading the book, I found very, very helpful, you know, to whatever degree, you know, a white person is capable of being an ally or taking action. I think at the very beginning is sort of education, self-education about the experience of being a black person in America, and that's not always easy or obvious to do when you don't experience it. But I think one of the things the book succeeds at is creating these scenarios where you're inside the character experiencing these dynamics and things you wouldn't otherwise be aware of, but she articulates in a way that's, you know, they're very potent. And it's accessible, and I think that's one of the successes of the book. Is it's a lens into that experience.
So, just thinking about, we have this 500-year legacy that we all around in this room and in this country are living with. I think about that, and I think about the way in which she talks about government and government not being fixed. We create these institutions and then we feel like the institutions just are and we have to respond to them. And sort of those two things together, I think, enable a different level of conversation, which is to say we all are products of our history,
mm-hmm.
that we're not, we can shift that around a little bit,
mm.
and that those institutions which human beings have created don't have to be those fixed forms. So it's not a fully formed thought that I have, but I think that there's something about that that she's playing with, that when you articulated, we, you know, there's this 500 year, yes, we know that, but somehow engaging the conversation, cognizant of that, really like, okay, that's right, we all are here. Which
the institutional thing, the 500 years of history. Mm-hmm. Because in a way, I guess, even when you pick up the book, Citizen, you think it might be something in political philosophy. It's Citizen. Just forget the American lyrics. Just go in the bookshop and you see that. So I think the book is really very, very powerful. And the idea of getting us to understand where we're coming from, but also is to see it against the background of the national history, you know. Okay. Citizenship is a matter of state. And state arrangements are an issue, they're a matter of delegated powers. If the policeman is not invested with that kind of power, you think about the shootings, you know. Person to person, forget the state now. If there was not, I think some of what we forget is that citizenship, the notion itself, is a matter of state. State powers. Okay? That policeman that doesn't care, he has these powers delegated to him by instruments of state to be the law enforcement person. And if he's not a principal person, you know, person that is kind of doesn't have any moral conscience, then the guns start flying. But the victim will not be there if it weren't for this delegated power. That's why I find this, as a political philosopher and as a poet, I find this very fascinating. You know, if you just saw the book, Citizen, you might be thinking she's writing a book in political philosophy, on governance. And then you get into it and you begin to see how the lives of individuals get played out, and the emotional response of the writer, the artist, you know. Over here, on many occasions when we've had readings, I've had occasion to call attention to this wonderful phrase from Gardner, young Gardner, in Moral Fiction, that what moves the great artists of our time, you know, is this sense of glory obstructed. A glimpsed wholeness shattered, he says. That's the creative aesthetic level. That the broken world, if you were really interested in the dignity of the human person, whether you find them in Africa, Asia, or here, this sense of, what really motivates the great artists of our time is this sense of, I quote him, of glory obstructed, a glimpsed wholeness shattered. Okay? And then, of course, you might see this stuff and say, well, you can concentrate on the obstruction and forget the underlying glory that was obstructed. You can forget, you know, and talk about a glimpse wholeness. Yeah. And concentrate on the shatteredness and forget that wholeness that was shattered. So, it's where the aesthetic appeal then comes in, but is a question of delegated powers. The policeman carries the bag and carries the gun. He's not gonna, you know, if Trayvon Martin's older brother or so, if he had one, come out and try to, you know, deal with the police, then he's accused of assaulting a police officer. Let's not forget the question of the 500 year history, the complementarities of state. You live in a state. You're a citizen of a state. You and I are no longer on a person-to-person thing where if you whack me or whack my sister or whack my wife or my mother and I come after you, it doesn't happen anymore. It's a question. So you cannot count on the moral integrity of the people who then enforce the laws. And that's, I think, part of it. That's part of the strength of this book. Take it. Just read Citizen. I know you think it was. You write a political philosophy book. No. It's, so the convergence of the philosophy and the literary production is what fascinates me about this book. And that's what led me to do my own little reflection on calling all citizens. You know? So, but I think this is really important that you bring up this issue of, 500 years of history and the Americans are kind of joined, you know, the never dealing with this mess. But the sadness for some of us is just the way it really destroys the situated dignities of everyone, white and black, but especially blacks on the receiving end of this thing, you know.
Does she say that? Does she say that the dignity of only the blacks is destroyed? Does she say that?
No.
I think she thinks that's the whole. I think that's one of the points of the book, that she makes white people visible in a way that shows what's destroyed in them by what they're doing, and that whole piece by about Serena.
Brings
that to the fore. Are they doing?
What is happening?
Why are they acting like this? Yes. What's going on?
That's
so Serena is going on about her business, it would seem to me, and doing what Serena does. But it's really about whatever that, I can't remember offhand, one of her, the person who put the butt on.
Yeah.
And what was she doing?
She thought it was in jest and in fun, you know?
But
you know, when I raised this issue, who are these people that she mentioned, you know, that presentation, you know, I think she obviously, later on she pointed out how at the conference, going in the hallway, then seeing this middle-aged white woman who was really weeping profusely, shaking. And the same things that disturbed her, you know, Claudia Rankine to raise this incredible question. As I said, it was very powerful for me. Who are these people? Then she and this woman embraced each other. The same things that disturb Serena, Claudia, you know, was also what was leading this lady to cry. She had friends across racial line. She was weeping for the country, weeping for her friendship. And all of a sudden, a look of recognition happened, and they embraced each other. So it gives you hope. Okay, that's the point I was actually trying to make, you know, because this, who are these people with T-H-I-S? It's not the same thing as who are T-H-E-S-E. It gives us some hope that something, maybe, if everything worked out well, we can also begin to climb together, make this journey together. But if when it is also essentialized, you know, then
when I think about citizen as a word, I am reminded that it's always been a contingent identity. That citizenship in the U.S. has always been based on millions of people not being allowed to be citizens. So it wasn't until 1924 that indigenous people and Big Turtle Island were recognized as citizens. And I'm thinking about Puerto Ricans who are U.S. citizens but were treated as anything but citizens. And then, you know, the 65 million refugees in the world who now have a contingent identity in terms of their citizenship. And one of the people that Diane interviewed in Greece, you know, had his hands open saying, you know, I have no country. I have no country. He had just gotten off the raft, right, from Turkey to Greece. And there's, you know, millions of people in that category. So it's made, and I think about, you know, Vietnam vets, black Vietnam vets, black vets coming back after World War II, you know, who were then lynched. So what does citizenship even mean if you have it? Which makes me yearn for a concept and a sense of belonging that's bigger than citizen, that goes beyond nation state, because the nation state, as I see it, has failed as a way of allowing people to belong. And so that leads me to, well, what are the spiritual dimensions of belonging that go beyond the state? And I think about Veronica Watson's beautiful book on the souls of white folk, you know, obviously drawing from Du Bois. And what are the souls of white folk if they're based on 500 years of degradation? And I think about, you know, Roediger's wonderful work on black on white, where he includes all these black philosophers and theorists and poets who know so much more about whiteness than white people do, as guides for us in this spiritual quest of belonging that goes beyond the state.
There's a very, very powerful point, you know, the large picture of these individuals that live within this thing. And sometimes history just affects us in so many ways, you know.
I do want to comment on the history, though, because I think we might be overstating how historical history is, because a big part of what I think Citizen is calling our attention to is how it echoes, and not just echoes, but it's reproduced in the present moment, these so-called historical violences and exclusions. So just kind of like as a counter to, yes, we're talking about a 500-year history, but we're still in that historical moment.
Yeah, it's not complete. It's still ongoing. The uncompleted past, you know, but in Duberman, the uncompleted past, you know. Robert Hayden came and gave a reading, you know, at Wellesley some years ago, and I asked him if he could read that middle passage poem again, and this old man started crying. You thought slavery, the middle passage was all over. No. I was surprised at his reaction. I was surprised at my own reaction when I was sitting before I retired. Middle passage, Hayden started weeping.
But Du Bois had to leave home at 93. So I think that tells you something that he thought it hadn't changed either. When you have to get up at 93 and leave home, you know that something very powerful is pushing you out. After you spent your whole life trying to solve the problem. Or write about the problem so someone can solve it. So I think that people who spend their lives trying to solve the problem or thinking about this do get to a point of feeling like they must weep. And what's his name's book? Faces of the Bob, Derek Bell's book. I think that's kind of where he got to at the end of his life, because he worked so hard and done so much. And still thought we were still in history.
Are there some ways, you know, in which this fact of race and the problem, what are the ways in which it affects individual whites? And in the sense that maybe it's making life kind of unfulfilled? The victims of police violence were the black victims of police violence, you know, there's something very immediate in that. But is there something else too that white, black people, friends can see, well, this thing is really doing this stuff to me also as a white person? I don't know whether there may be some ways to begin to articulate some of those injuries, maybe hidden, they're not as visible. People come back from Vietnam. I saw a guy right at the intersection of Commonwealth and Mass Ave many years ago. He's probably dead. But around 6 o'clock, I never learned how to drive, as many of you know. I'm coming home from Wellesley on the Wellesley bus, and this guy is out there with sticks, you know, reenacting Vietnam. And we talk about the hidden injuries of war. Some come back maimed, some are brought back in a coffin. Some come back with their bodies all on the surface damaged. I wonder if there is an analog to this in terms of sensitive, caring, reflecting, thinking, white folk, well, this thing is also doing some kind of a number on me. And there are some instances where one might say, look, I have black friends, you know, they are more in danger of being shot by police for nothing. So the victim assignment is very direct and straight. But are there some ways in which I myself am a victim of this systemic practice, even though I'm not on the receiving end on the individual level?
I was just gonna say, the one thing that really gets me is to see people suffering. And that may be kind of one part of an answer to your question. Like, even though you're not living the experience and you don't understand it the way a black person might, like, just to know that people are out there suffering, and that, you know, a child, playing with a toy gun is shot, like, that's pretty awful, awful stuff. And I know I get very upset thinking about it. And while it may not be, you know, there may not be like a direct comparison, like, to see people suffering makes you suffer too, in kind of a weird indirect way.
Are there also some cases where maybe because one may have some friends of different racial backgrounds, that some damage, the awkwardness now in terms of your dealing with people that you actually know, not just the sense of an abstract child that is being destroyed in some place, but people that I know who happen to be black or Chinese or white, who are caught in the crossfire, that the damage, the damage it might be doing to
okay, maybe.
Yeah. No, you're right. I mean, the sadness about people suffering, but the other level of that sadness might also be what actual children of friendships that have been destroyed, that some of whom you happen to know.
Yeah, I do have some black friends, and like, it is, you know, it's weird because I almost don't think of them. And maybe this kind of speaks to the book too. It's not like I think of them as black. I think of them just, oh, it's a whole person. And I guess to think of that whole person as something bad happening to them, that would be
Very Okay, yeah, a little bit, yeah.
Well, just, you know, I'm just trying to think of like what, you can't think of America without thinking about the contribution of Black America to us. I mean, you can't even imagine what it would be like, this country, without the contributions from the African American community and and other communities. It's the writing and the art and the exquisite music and on and on and on. It is a huge loss to us to not just be in love with the people of the world. You know, there's been so many things contributed to this culture that you can't, it's unimaginable without.
We just happen to be in town and we have to catch a train.
Oh.
So
I would like to add one thing before we head out,
which is that
I think the damage is emotional stuntedness, right? It's the inability to actually have relations with other people and to kind of create this amorphous, like, commentary on human connection or contributions when there is a real absence of emotional connectedness. And I think that's the... that's what the philosopher Charles Ignaz will call epistemic ignorance, right? It's like racism is so insidious that you can't even know yourself. And in that inability to know yourself, how can you know others? And that, I think that's the damage, which then is hard to even see, right? Because it's already there. So,
and we can be made abstractions because we're so segregated from each other. And so the few black friends that you have, or maybe the lot that you have, get to get to be oddities in certain ways, because as you say, you don't think of them as black. Well,
I know race is a part of their identity, but I don't, I don't.
Well, the point is that what we just say that it's if things, if the emotional stuntedness wasn't here and the society will, would think of them as black because they are black.
Yeah, I think of them as black too. I just don't. It's not something I'm kind of like constantly thinking about when I'm talking to them.
Yeah, I see that.
Well, this is really good. One very quick question right now before you guys leave. There's
yes,
a friend.
Okay,
good. Before you go, I have a friend from the Cameroons. He came and did some work in Wisconsin. He said the first time I knew I was black was when I got here, when I came to America.
Right.
That's a very interesting observation. The first time I knew I was black was when I got to America. So, but again, you can see how this.
Thank you very much for this.
Thank you very much. And how do you.
I'm from Ghana.
Ghana.
I knew I was black before I came to the US.
All right. Well, and thank you guys for coming. Did you sign up so we can keep the photo and our things?
Yes, we did.
Okay. Travel well.
Bye.
Thank you.
Travel well. Thanks for coming.
I was going to say that I feel like as a white person, I suffer because I've been deprived of my full humanity. I mean, by not having had meaningful relationships with people of other cultures, really, and having grown up with unspoken fears or there were certain neighborhoods, we didn't drive into. Certain relationships that I might have had. There was someone in a summer school program who was interested in me, and I went to coffee with him once. But there was part of me that I defended against entering into a more intimate relationship. And I don't mean physically, but emotionally. Even though my parents were, liberals and in favor of civil rights, yet there were so many unspoken assumptions about the groups that I would be in, the schools I would go to. And I too am on the receiving end, not to the same extent that Claudia Rankine describes in her book. I think that's the way in which we all are, have suffered, we're white, from a systematic racism. So permeates, society and even my life, even though I don't go around thinking about it, but it's there, and maybe that's part of the tragedy is I don't go around thinking about it as actively as someone who is black does, because my race is more invisible, but I think there are scars there. As a white person, I have.
I worked in a school system for 20 years that is the most diverse community in the South Shore. And I think the population is of African American and black was like 55-60%. And it had changed over the years. And one of the things that was just really obvious, but I don't think people were really admitting, is the institutionalized racism in the school system itself. And basically what you see, there are different levels in the school. There's the honors, there's the APs, there's the level ones and level twos, and the special ed. And the disproportionate amount of students who were in special ed who were black or African American. It was really clear that was it. But my school, it's the high school, introduced this program called SEED, which was run by a woman from the Philippines. Mm-hmm. And in this program, all different races of staff were in this. Mm-hmm. And what came out for me partially also was it isn't just, it's ignorance. Like one of the ideas that I grew up thinking, and I felt like I was probably a racist, and this idea was that I couldn't see the differences, and still don't necessarily see the differences, of different people of Asian backgrounds. Mm-hmm. Okay, I couldn't always tell
Chinese
which which group was from where. And the woman who ran the program, who was Filipino, from the Philippines, and some other people said, it isn't racist, it's lack of experience. It's lack of having exposure. I mean, I'm not saying that they're still worth a part of, but not being involved in cultures where you get to see the differences, when you just have a sort of different here and there, you don't always get acclimated to understanding which cultures are which Asian populations from what countries and stuff, which was very helpful. The whole dialogue of opening up and being able to be like here, expose yourself and say, well, I felt like maybe something was wrong with me because I couldn't identify someone from the Philippines versus Japan versus China at one point, you know what I'm saying? So I think that having that ability to have places to say things opens the dialogue to exposing ignorance and lack of experience that would help once you get through that, having that vulnerability out there that you talked about being vulnerable, having that exposure. Like I walked around this for years thinking horrible things about myself, thinking that. And by her saying that to me, I felt slightly liberated because I was attaching something negative onto something that was not necessarily negative.
Negative. It's a question of, you know, how much is it the tragedy of perception, a tragedy of greed, or moral, you know, failure. Like, you know, if you haven't had the experience, you know, and even as a footnote to that, you know, the Japanese also felt a sense of racial superiority to the Chinese, the Rape of 19 during the Second World War. So it's kind of interesting too, you know, where people would see as natural kind of brothers or clusters, you know, the Japanese military staff, you know, from history, the so-called Rape of 19, you know, where, and the Koreans too, the comfort women, the trouble history between Japan and Korea. So from here, we say the Asian group, I can't tell which one. And then within that too, there's all these other things going. So it's like a very complicated, really difficult, messy situation.
And these dialogues are
critical. And the dialogues are important. Yeah.
So finally, I was thinking about this before I had to step out. And I think what you can put racism inside of a more universal problem, which is thinking of the other. And we see it in play in our society in so many different ways. Certainly the black-white dynamic is perhaps the biggest one, the most pernicious one, but it's across the board, whether it's political, religious, geographical, and sadly, we have, quote, leaders, politicians, public figures that play upon it for their own ends and make it that much worse. And it's not only in our society, I think it's global, as you were just alluding to.
The other. Yeah. I think you had your hand up and then you again.
Sure. As an individual matter, I don't know that there's any benefit to confronting these problems if you're white, any individual benefit to confronting them. Unless you just consider truth a benefit, or you know, helping yourself become a better person a benefit, but the you know, joy and happiness and being okay with others is probably on the side of not recognizing any of this stuff. Since it's a racist country, you fit in a lot better if you just move with a racist flow. You know, maybe not so easily in Cambridge, your little lefty enclaves of the country, but in 99% of it, you're probably gonna feel happier not thinking of these things. It may be that as a corporate or collective matter, it's good to recognize it. So you can see, oh, racism leads us to sell the country to Donald Trump, which leads us to run out of oxygen and, you know, water and all kinds of things down the road. But as an individual matter, that's the flow for 500 years that everybody's been on. And I don't know that in Citizen she's saying that you'll feel better if you confront these problems. And I think she's talking about her encounter with a whole lot of people who are kind of emotionally incontinent, right, who just say stuff that maybe they shouldn't say, or say things that they might feel are true that they actually should just lie about feeling. I mean, I lie about feelings all the time. It enables a whole lot of friendships that I have. So I have a friend who's super disabled. I don't say, you're super disabled to him. And I'm surprised that he can do all the things that he does. But I act like I'm not surprised, because otherwise I'm a jerk that he shouldn't hang out with, who's surprised that he is so normal and that he's overcome so much. So there are lots of ways in which you might have some thing about you that's awful, right? That I just confessed, like how I feel about my friend's disability. But that's not how I think about it. And so I don't just blurt out my feelings to be true to my feelings. So I think there's, you know, there's been some discussion of truth, but I think that's not the kind of truth that people should, that the author is asking us to take away from the book, right? They're just saying what you feel because we can all work it out. Saying what you feel might mean, oh, I don't talk to you again.
Before,
or my friend David doesn't talk to me again because I said what I felt.
So one of the things you feel, the additional stuff that Rankin would like for us to take away from the book, if you were, you know, if you could say, you know, suggest, is there some other thing that we might want to add while you're still on this topic? I think, you know, what you would like for us to pick up in addition, you know. But you're not asking you to feel good, you know, say whatever.
Yeah, I think it's not, I mean, like, I mean, it's a big American thing to say everything that would be good for
like
your soul will feel
yeah.
good, right? This is how you can feel, take the pain away.
Yeah.
But that's not what she's prescribing,
yeah.
right? It's not it might be a book about virtue, some kind of civic virtue, but it's not a book about how to feel better about yourself or win friends or influence people. At least on my reading of her book.
Carol, 1 second. I think she had her hand up. Then you.
Yeah. I guess I just wanted to respond. It what keeps coming up for me is how complicated and fraught it is to even talk about this. But I'm sorry that Diane left, because I wanted to thank her for. Basically, she said, if we assume that we're all racist, then we can be open about this. We can say things. We're allowed to make mistakes. Because if you make a mistake, and then I would encourage you to call someone on it. If someone says something, you know, it's the only way we're ever gonna get somewhere. Otherwise, we're just dancing around each other. And the emotional stuntedness part two really resonated with me, because I feel like as someone who actually cares about this, I've become much more uncomfortable trying to reach out to someone of a different race than I used to be, because I'm so afraid of saying the wrong thing or doing the wrong thing. And what I would like is for whoever is affronted by me to feel comfortable telling me, because the only way we can learn is to know what our oversights are.
Yeah,
oh, go ahead.
Yeah,
go ahead.
No, I was just going to say Claudia Rankin's husband is white, and we have a mixed race marriage, and we have biracial children. And one of the things that sort of shocks me every once in a while is I remember when they were little, we had, you know, friends that had children the same age who were white, and the parents would say, "Oh, this is Cambridge. There's no race. You know, no problem with race." And I was shocked, and yet on the other hand, I wanted to tell them incident after incident that my children had been through, but I felt like they'll find out, and I still love these people because they're the ones who love my children as well. And so it was kind of like letting off a little bit, you know, so that they, knowing that they'll see, eventually they'll see, I hope, you know.
Which kind of raises an interesting issue? What's your name?
Ellen.
And then,
Anthony.
This is really good. Thank you both very much. If you have racial blind spots, does it make you a racist? Is there a difference? I don't know. I'm just raising a question. Whether occasions of racial insensitivity, whether it's because of ignorance, people not being familiar, or just the humans, you know, the other that you were defining, or you. What is your point about how it held you back from certain, you know, if if one black or white shows racial blind spots, at what point does, how many acts of racial stuff, you know, do you need before you become a racist? Or should we make any difference between the two expressions?
Well, doesn't it depend on if you can learn from your mistake? If you make a mistake and do you learn from it? If you don't learn from it or you don't care, mm-hmm. then I guess that makes you a racist. As opposed to saying, that hurt you. And I didn't mean it, but I can see what assumptions I brought to this conversation mm-hmm. that might have hurt you. So it, you know, for me, I think it is individual and one-on-one, and you start with yourself and try to work on yourself mm-hmm. in order to overcome that mm-hmm. yourself. Mm-hmm. I mean, I feel as if our whole structure and our whole society and culture is racist and sexist, and it's decades and centuries.
Right.
And so the only way we're going to fix it is one individual and one person at a time, and passing that down to our children.
Yeah. And hold on,
I was sort of struck by this idea that, like, before I started thinking about racial politics, it was more natural for me to interact with black people. This is something that I've heard before, mm-hmm. and I think that it sort of, and it relates to this question of racial blind spots too, and so it's sort of like almost an idea of like ignorance is bliss mm-hmm. sort of thing. Mm-hmm. And I think that there's a passage in the book, the fiction of facts assumes innocence, ignorance, lack of intention, misdirection, the necessary condition of a certain time and place, and then have you seen their faces? So this sort of fiction of facts, I think, is there you have an experience, and then for some people maybe who aren't as engaged in thinking about these questions critically, they sort of it's second nature to them to convert that experience into a sort of historical moment that is no longer that pure experience, but is now been converted into something that is somehow like is somehow cohesive with an idea of liberal values, or an idea of a universal mm-hmm. universal good, or mm-hmm. sort of there. And so that has to do with these questions of intention, of being in a certain time and place and things like that. And I think that process of, you could think of it as lying to yourself or something like that, mm-hmm. but there's this sort of neurotic historicizing of moments, I think, that we experience mm-hmm. with like with other races, to make them fit into a larger idea of these sort of values. And I think it speaks to your original question about sort of the different competing suffrage movements mm-hmm. versus a universal suffrage movement. Mm-hmm. The idea that like the citizen and that the way that our state works is based on some universal absolute, mm-hmm. When in fact it's sort of, it becomes much more difficult once you realize that absolute doesn't really exist, and it's impossible to reconcile these racist moments we have with an idea of a universal, liberty, justice for all sort of idea, and that like, in the end of the day, it's like the material dimension of these things is probably more important.
Yeah, this is interesting because, you know, as a matter of fact, talking about fact, you know, facere, the Latin word, facticity, artifact, there's a makingness mm-hmm. of fact, you know, like Duncan's great book, 50 Certainties, but fact,
constructedness of fact.
Facere, to make, mm-hmm. artifact, mm-hmm. facticity, this, one should say this fact, wow, it's loaded, and of course, the gravitas of it. It doesn't move anymore.
So I have a question that I've always wanted to ask, probably in this kind of environment, mm-hmm. And it may show my ignorance.
That's okay.
But whatever
that's
it
okay,
is.
Mona.
I wondered, when Obama got elected, mm-hmm. would it have been healthier for the country if they had not put it that he was a black president, but he was a biracial president? Because I wonder if that would have really brought out the news that maybe this country could have seen both black and white, rather than it would have joined the forces together. And I've thought about that a lot, and I wasn't sure if maybe that was showing racial blindness, or if maybe that would have really brought the country together more, rather than separating it and putting it on racial lines, because he bridged that gap in his background. And I really felt that there was a moment there that we could have benefited as a country from accepting that. And
it's very interesting.
And what would have happened had his mother been alive and the country had seen him kissing his white mother? I mean, what? No, I actually have puzzled over that as well. Like, her not being alive and present in that way. I don't know. It could have gone many different ways.
I just think it could have been a unifying aspect for this country that is so blatantly has issues here.
Mm-hmm.
So that was just a thing that's always kept coming up, and it still comes up for me, that I wonder if that would have been a more unifying approach.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Very interesting.
Absolutely not.
Yeah, I don't think so.
You don't think so?
I think he was presented as biracial.
Yeah.
We all heard the stories of who his parents were, and but one drop of black blood means you're black in America, and you're treated as black.
I think the comment speaks to what you were saying earlier about how, like, there's no, you know, the qualify doctors and lawyers and professors as white, but you qualify them as black.
Mm-hmm.
I think it speaks more to that. And, like, I think even the word diversity operates on those terms.
Yeah.
Like, for example, if it doesn't, it's a coded term.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I work at a school that is
mm-hmm.
90% Latino,
mm-hmm.
and they are always praised for their diversity.
Mm-hmm.
And the kids are usually the only ones to say, how is this diversity? We're all brown. Why is it? Isn't diversity mean difference? But it's just a code word for, like, having people of color in the building.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, no, actually, thank you for bringing this up, because this is the benefit of this kind of thing, you know, with small groups, friends, and we can talk, you know. It may not be that what you're suggesting might have made any difference, because the people knew the history of race is still very heavy, but
mm-hmm.
the very fact of actually being able to talk is nice, it's good, it's important.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, we wouldn't get around from this thing. Yeah. Reggie, were you raising your hand up? No? I didn't know what okay.
One other thing I wanted to say, I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, I didn't know whether she had a hand up. I thought I saw a hand over there, okay.
In my school, one of the things that you talked about, the different backgrounds, different Asian, different populations. In my school, it was really sad because amongst the black and African American population, because they delineated, because I had a lot of people from Haiti, a lot of people who were not, but they distinguished between people who were dark and light,
mm-hmm.
even in the black, and they used to, they within their own, I mean, I used to have discussions with them about this, and they discriminated themselves on who they would date
mm-hmm.
and who they wouldn't date,
mm-hmm.
and it's same thing to me, even in countries like Israel,
mm-hmm.
where the Orthodox and the secular,
mm-hmm.
I mean, there's such divisions even amongst the people themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember someone saying to me in Israel, you're not going to get people in Israel to really be totally with everyone else until they can deal with their own issues
mm-hmm.
of between the secular and the Orthodox and the Haredi.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just, it's prevalent amongst the groups themselves who are dealing with the issues too. And it's very sad.
Well, this is where the whole issue then comes up. Is there some learning going on here where, like, an inherited lens since the game of power and discrimination has been played, so that these groups themselves, when you've done quite know what your neighbor is gonna do, and you want to have an ascendancy of power over them, and there's already this invidious practice of discrimination, you know. So you learn people, even these groups now, you know, whether the blacks want more light skin or the Hispanic want more light skin. But that invention of racial scale did not necessarily come from the particular group you're talking about.
Right.
So there's this.
Right, it's been imposed upon them.
Well, people inherit these lands,
right.
and the people with power over there have. And then it's really not a particular thing, you know, where they're dumb, they're not smart. You know, even the history of Europe and Nazism, you know. You guys are a very intelligent Jewish group, they're smart, they're creative, and yet, you see what I'm saying? It doesn't depend on the. Normally you might say, oh, well, I don't want that because they're kind of stupid, they're dumb, you know. You couldn't do that. And then, of course, so where does it begin? This,
right.
Yeah, this, yeah. People that are, the sense of discrimination, where you say, of course, we can do this because after all, we are the better people.
Right.
And then you have situations where, by all accounts, the people you are trying to beat up on, you know, they're intellectuals, they're physicians, they're physicists, they're musicians, and you know, people can put their fingers on it. You know, they want that racial thing begin, and then we inherit it, and then but you know, this. Thank you very much for. But I think one of the things we want to actually look at in terms of the sources one of the things I've come across in some of my research too, you know, in terms of the moral psychology of it too, was kind of interesting too for us with this, you know, that even the Nazis themselves, you know, when the Hitler started his nonsense, you know, the killing was supposed to have been done by the regular German soldiers. Eh? Then they go out and do all the killing of children, and then they come home, and they have to sit down and eat dinner with their five-year-old little girls. Mm-hmm. It was doing a number to them. They couldn't fight anymore. So then you had to set up a separate killing unit, the SS. Do you see the psychology of it?
Yeah.
You know, these brave German soldiers, the tough guys, we train them, and then you tell them to do this thing, they come home, they can eat dinner with their five-year-old little girl, become basket cases.
Yeah.
So you learn your lesson, and then you have to set up a separate killing unit. It does a number on people, you know. In fact, as a matter of fact, in Africa, you know, whether in East Africa, people go among the Kikuyu, you go up at a group is attacked, so you have a war of self-defense. But even after you come back from defending yourself, the spilling of blood is heavy. So the young men have to go through a ritual cleansing. They have to be cleansed before they come back. It wasn't a bad war. People were defending themselves. But the very fact that you have to spill blood in order to, you know, the groups understood that human blood is not easy. They had to go through a cleansing ritual to be reintegrated into society.
Wow. I mean, it may be, and this is the feeling one gets from the book about the author's opinion, that American racism is such that it has done that number on most people, and it's what makes Americans so different from people in other industrialized, you know, high capitalism countries, right? The kind of belief systems that white Americans have vary wildly from what people believe in France or Germany or Norway or Iceland. Our political system is only close to those because of the way non-white people vote when they vote. Right? Donald Trump isn't somebody with a chance in other industrialized countries. He's not somebody who has a chance among people of color. The only people in the industrialized world that vote in that kind of direction in large numbers are white Americans.
Because of this history of
And it may be that racism is so widespread here, so much more so than everywhere else, that it's done its number on such a large number of citizens.
I don't agree with that. Because in Western Europe, we have the phenomena of these same types of characters rising in popularity. What they're doing, though, is very similar to what he's done here, in that he's playing one group off against another. So it isn't about race as much, but it is about, for example, immigrants. So in France, you had that dynamic. And to some extent, in some of the former Iron Curtain countries, the same thing is happening. The rise of nationalism and demagoguery is there, but it's not the same as what we're experiencing here because of the race, and the race is the difference.
Well,
you're talking about black race versus maybe Asian and Muslim too.
I'm not saying that there isn't racism in
Europe.
Western Europe or Northern Europe.
Yeah.
It is there. I'm saying that there's a kind of widespread pattern and practice of it here that doesn't exist there. And then when one looks at sort of opinion polls on things that Americans believe, you know, by which one means white Americans, they show a group that has really almost no relationship to white people in Europe or Northern Europe. You know, it's a very different population.
Yes.
We don't see it as vividly because what white Americans believe gets countered by, you know, a significant group of dissidents. But also people of color believe very different things here.
This is a slightly different path, but you know, you invited us to think about how we as white people have been injured by racism, and you just talked a little bit about how, you know, when people go to war, you know, in certain places there's rituals, you can't do this. And I think about the reconciliation that has happened, you know, the countries who have taken reconciliation as a way of, the context is changing. We want to change the way in which those either laws or unwritten mores, the way in which we've behaved. How do we do that? Because we've harmed people in the other way. And what's been interesting to me as I've been sitting here thinking is it's really hard for me to think about, I can think about how my life would have been much more enriched had I not grown up in a racist culture. But it's really, like, how have I been injured? It's a really different thing for me to be looking at. And a piece of it is the fact that I'm in a privileged position, and I'm not used to thinking as a person in a privileged position, how have I been harmed? And yet, of course, I've been harmed. But it's like, as I've been sitting here and I've really been thinking about that question, I'm hard-pressed to say all of the... I thank you for asking that question, because I think we all are. And I've thought a lot about how people who have been oppressed have been injured by this, but not so much how I, as a person in a more privileged class, have also been, you know... And as a woman, I've thought about... It's a really interesting other lens by which to engage in the conversation and also to try to build bridges with people who might have different backgrounds. So thank you.
I think that a way that a lot of white people in this country have been injured by the systemic racism is in not being more up in arms about, so this book is really hard to discuss because it talks about microaggression and then it talks about the blatant killing of innocent, or, you know, the blatant killing, unnecessary killing of black people. And I'm wondering if the tradition of slavery and the allowing of slaves to be, you know, violence against slaves has somehow translated into it being okay with this country to watch so much violence against black people and not be out in the streets saying, this is wrong, it's not humane, we are all humans. Why are we, privileged white people, sitting in our houses watching the television going, oh my God, why aren't we more vocal about it? What is allowing us to allow this to happen?
Yeah. Is it? Yeah, Mona, yeah.
I was just going to say, Ken Berman did that 18 hours worth of Vietnam.
Ken Burns,
sorry about that. And one of the things that was clear in that was that a lot of the people, a good amount of the people who were people who were black and poor, mm-hmm. and a lot of the people who were drafted and went over to Vietnam. Mm-hmm. And that's sort of an indirect way of violence towards black people. When you think about that too, and he really exposed this in that 18 hours. I don't know if you got to see it, but it was pretty awful to watch 18 hours worth of this, but it was very revealing about all the cultures involved, all the different people. And it was a predominant group of people who ended up going over to Vietnam.
And things didn't change until white college age kids mm-hmm. started dying over there.
Exactly.
Then the white middle class decided, oh, this is a bad war.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And the opioid.
Oh, yeah.
And then they lost.
Mm-hmm. And then they
lost. And then the U.S. lost to mm-hmm. the war. Right.
Well, they'd lost long
they'd
before
lost,
that.
Yeah. It was a totally
right.
non-winnable war.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, earlier, I mean, you said something about white people like sitting in their houses, right? Watching the TV and, you know. But then when African Americans or black people tried to say Black Lives Matter, white people just went crazy. You know, they just went off. White, what do you mean? What do you mean Black Lives Matter? As if saying Black Lives Matter means white life doesn't matter. And it was just so insane. But it's an example of how, you know, the way white people think and are, like you can't even say Black Lives Matter. Or that's somehow problematic. Or it means to many white people, if you say Black Lives Matter, to many white people that means but our lives don't. And to me that was just so absurd to say that in response to Black Lives Matter. Made no sense.
Yeah, I think that the sort of paradox of white fragility where you have a population that has sort of the upper hand in every way being somehow demonstrating this tremendous sensitivity to, you know, interpreting everything as if it's an affront to their racial identity or something. And you see this also with the sort of idea of like freedom of speech on campus
mm-hmm.
and stuff like that is like demonstrated white fragility. And I think that shows the strength of this sort of neurotic urge to interpret the world and in a certain way. And
mm-hmm.
as soon as an event happens or somebody experiences something
mm-hmm.
to align it with a sort of larger idea of what America means and what the values are that America stands for. And I think that in terms of talking about war, one thing that I think was particularly interesting in terms of coming to understand the relationship between domestic issues of race and foreign policy is the idea that Colin Kaepernick's protesting of the flag is disrespectful to people who are fighting abroad. And in that debate, you hear the same type of discourse that you've heard for hundreds of years, but most memorably in my life from George W. Bush talking about like the invasion of Iraq being for to defend American values. So this notion that like we, this same value structure that I think is sort of neurotically defended by white people to an extent where they say things that make no sense, or they seem to overreact to things so much when if someone suggests that this isn't, you know, the land of the free or whatever, that same value structure is somehow, as soon as that gets brought into the debate, it becomes much easier for the right, I think, to say, well, and it's hard to prove that any of these wars have done anything for democracy, liberty, justice, or freedom, but that connection is how the right can discount Colin Kaepernick also, which I think is interesting.
Can discount what?
Colin Kaepernick.
Oh.
Say that,
about, you know.
Yeah, sort of connect the domestic issue of race to the foreign policy issue.
Did I see your hand there? I thought you were okay. Did you have something to say? I didn't know. Are you okay?
Yeah. Well, I like what you said about the neurotic impulse.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder if that couldn't be extended to actually explain the thing you were describing, that people like racism, right? They like engaging in it, they like knowing it's there, and they like thinking about it, they like seeing it as a big system. Not everybody,
mm-hmm.
but enough people to keep the system going. That's the reward it gives, not necessarily a financial or
mm-hmm.
political reward, but there's a tremendous psychic, even physical reward, how people
mm-hmm.
feel about their bodies.
Mm-hmm.
And with war,
mm-hmm.
like the kind of pleasure that we could see washing over people
mm-hmm.
during those racist attacks on other countries,
mm-hmm.
erases the possibility of making any argument with them,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
You can talk to somebody intellectually about the evils of pornography,
mm-hmm.
but when they're watching it, right, and they're addicted to it, your argument is just, they're not gonna hear you. They'll get embarrassed when you catch them with it.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't mean that they won't be alone with it again later in the voting booth or in the, you know, dark place watching these movies.
So racism is satisfactory on some level, I guess?
Well, there's a, it is a bodily feeling, right, that people have. And I think they experience it in these, thinking about these wars that we are fighting, and that might be why they're so immune to argument.
Yes, I just wanted to go back to your point about young black men being drafted in Vietnam, and I think that ties into a much bigger issue in that, you know, I graduated from high school very recently, and I know that in my public school career, you know, I came from one of the best school districts in the area, and we never learned about that. You know, we look at even wars like Vietnam, Korea, World War I, World War II are seen very much and taught as white wars. Like, we don't hear about, you know, the black divisions in war. Our most successful platoon in World War I was a black platoon from Harlem
mm-hmm.
who saved the most amount of American lives. And we're never allowed to be buried in a military graveyard because by the time they came back from World War I, you know, we had laws against that. And I think, and it goes into the entirety of education, and you know, we learn extensively about the Holocaust, as we should, an awful thing. We never learn about the Rwandan genocides. We barely learn about the genocide the Belgium committed in the Congo. And that is a history that is tied to America and is a global history that we are not teaching children, and the next generation is not getting. And I think it's raising generations of people who know black America only through slavery. And on that note, you know, we teach that, I mean, obviously in a lot of places we teach that slavery was bad, as it was. However, then you turn to the news and you see all these people who are trying to defend Confederate flags and Confederate statues. And I feel like a lot of the children nowadays, especially white children in schools, are not learning what they need to be learning about black people in America, and that they have been a part of American history more than just the civil rights movement. You know, they've been there for our wars and they've been there for our successes, but we never hear about them. So thank you for bringing that up, because it's important. It's important to see that erasure.
Something that I'm just thinking about, and thinking about this dynamic of racism in the United States, while it probably existed since the first settlers, one thing that I think really has given it life is that in the South, the majority of Southerners did not have slaves. Most were poor white.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But they embraced and supported the concept of slavery because the powerful slave owners convinced them that, you know, somehow the slaves were a threat to them, somehow the slaves were inferior to them, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that mentality took hold initially probably in the South, but became widespread in our whole society.
Mm-hmm.
And certainly in the antebellum period,
mm-hmm.
Andrew Johnson actually probably was the architect of making that widespread.
Mm-hmm.
During Reconstruction, former slaves that had been freed were supposed to be able to enjoy the rights of all citizens.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. It was Andrew Johnson who destroyed that.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, there was maybe a window of opportunity in that era for our society to go a different direction.
But it didn't. But, you know, we keep hoping that this old thing will, you know, but I believe that a discussion like this is really very, very helpful. Mm-hmm. And I hope we can be, you know, expanded all through the country so small groups can get together and talk. And talk, you know, just it's good to have people talk to each other and not be intimidated or feel awkward. Because otherwise we can't get anywhere without.
It has to feel safe. You have to be able to feel safe that you can be open enough and not, you know, like pounce on.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you're not feeling safe,
mm-hmm.
you're not going to be discussing anything.
Yeah, anything. Yeah.
There's a book I read in my book group called Small Great Things. You wouldn't think it, but Jodi Picoult wrote this book.
Mm-hmm.
And it's from three points of view.
Mm-hmm.
One of a white supremacist who's something happens to her, and then a black woman, a nurse,
mm-hmm.
who gets convicted of, they're thinking, not convicted, but she gets put in there for, they say, killing his child.
Mm-hmm.
And a white, excuse me, middle class, I have a white middle class lawyer, female.
Mm-hmm.
And what I was shocked about was that it really opened up the discussion in the book of looking at the life through the black woman's eyes.
Mm-hmm.
Of how she saw the white lawyer, the female lawyer.
Mm.
And it really showed about this whole thing of privilege, being privileged, and how you take it for granted so much that you just don't see it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's sort of like invisible, like you were talking about invisible before.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, you don't realize it because you had it. And until you're exposed to what it means and what people who don't have it, which she does in this book, which I thought was brilliant, actually.
Mm-hmm.
So it's actually an interesting book to read.
So the answer to the question, Mona, I hope you give me some water.
I have it here.
Take your time, yeah. It's the issue of power in this whole thing. Time Magazine wrote an article once, many years ago. It was during the Black Pride 60s days. And they interviewed some like, high school student, I guess, in New York or Detroit. He says, they quoted him as saying, "We blacks are descended from princes. You whites are descended from lumpkin proletariat." Lumpkin. So it's interesting. When you think about it, it's kind of funny, you know, but the fact though is that if this young black kid or black woman or really felt deep down that he or she was superior to white people. But there's no power to back it up. There's not an institutional arrangement to back it up. So whatever private prejudices, a sense of ascendancy this person has, isn't it a here nor there? So the whole question of power, you know, some of it is consciously grabbed power, some of it is by default, the unintended consequences of prior societal action. But it builds over the years. So at some point, we got to keep our reflection, trying to figure out how this whole thing took hold and why it became effective, and what has power got to do with it. You can see it in today's economy too. Now, in the old days before, China is not a very strong country. The economy is very, very big, you know, has an ancient history. In the old days, you took an American guy, a woman from, you know, who may say, well, the Chinese sleep six to the room. People work hard, they're very industrious people, an ancient civilization, very smart. So the question of power to defend oneself, if people think you're nothing, and even if you think you're superior to somebody but you don't have the power, then it neutralizes the nastiness of what you feel inside. So at some point, we've got to kind of figure out how power and the whole question of history again plays out in this thing. Mm-hmm.
We blacks are descended from princes, and you whites are a bunch of lumpkin proletariat.
It's kind of funny, okay? That's fine. But if this young man then grew up to really seriously believe this, and then, oh, this white folk, yeah. what has it got to to back up his sense of ascendancy with? Nothing. Yeah. So race and power, and we keep thinking. But I really believe that conversations like this is really very, very important, you know, very important. You know, I personally, on my part, when people work together, people say, what is the relationship between your philosophy and your poetry? But, you know, as in poetry, when the words align themselves, you know, the consonants blend, or maybe they cancel each other, the vowels, the, you know, the rhythm that you hear. And the poem is well made. There's a certain way in which the parts fit themselves. They fit together. And I think that the same thing in Igbo, we have this expression, the word for rulership, for governance, is in Chikomai, it lets you go into the woods and you pick up a whole bunch of branches. And if you align them properly and then tie a rope, you can bring them together. But you can't bring all those refractory branches going every which way. So that's the interest of individuals within the state. And I think that citizenship, rights, the dignities of persons, where the political structure fits together, there's something very aesthetic, very nice about it. So there's, in my mind, there's this funny relationship between the political issue, whether on the international level, where human beings hang together in a nice collective symmetrical thing, and then the way the words themselves, if you were in aesthetics, you know, writing poetry, the way the words blend and hang together. So maybe I'm just stretching it too far, but I think the beauty that can come from Americans of all persuasions being able to hang together, and all this thing of us versus them, and the Africans live in huts and all that stuff, you know. There's nothing nice about the world together. It's an aesthetic feel, you know. Mm-hmm. So that's partly my own little prejudice. But I'd like to, the little time we have left, you know, the few people that, you know, it's really great. The participation has been great, you know. If you get somebody wants to say a word, more or two more words, I would love to hear you. They gave us little cards that I'm supposed to distribute, and then people can put down their thoughts, and then this could be sent back to them for the public dialogue on March 4th, you know, where Claudia Rankin will be there, and then any suggestions or questions people have, this could then be sent to the central location, and then they could use it as the basis for a public dialogue. And the play is in March, you know. We're getting some tickets, or
we will have some tickets to the public dialogue.
Okay,
sure.
Right.
But
will it be?
It's in Emerson. Emerson.
Yes, at Emerson.
Yeah, so we can get you some information on that.
Yeah.
But I'm supposed to pass out this stuff to people to jot down some of their thoughts or questions or responses to the discussion or whatever else they want to say, and then they can let Claudia reflect on some of these things, and but the play itself, the white card, will happen, and I think they're gonna give us. Well, they make some tickets available to us because the thing is all sold out. But I think if people really want to go,
it's not all sold out. But when I looked at the tickets for the block of tickets
they were reserved.
Oh, because when I just went in there, it looked like those were sold out, but there's many other dates. It goes to April 1st.
Okay, good. Yeah, but I think they said they were going to make some available to us, right? To the discussion groups?
No,
the discussion groups?
No, that they didn't. They did, and we emailed that to everybody, but the deadline to get those was February 9th, which we did send out an email to everybody who was on our list about that. So
the tickets that they were holding aside for these groups for the play have sold out, but you can still go to the play.
Oh, right. Okay, so you just go look up Emerson College.
Yeah,
and it's called White Park.
The American Repertory Theater.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, the American Rep.
You take one card and then you.
Oh, I've got. I got distracted. I wasn't trying to.
Anybody needs a pen? I have.
Pen.
So how do we get the tickets for the March 4th conversation?
Well, if you're interested, just let us know. I reserved 10.
You can get them.
But also, you should have gotten an email about that.
I think the hall is going to be big enough. I think that.
Those tickets are free. The public dialogue is free, yeah. But I did send emails, two or three emails, if
RSVP. Public dialogue.
But you can just call here if you're interested in the ticket and you can't find one. We'll have some extras. For that public dialogue. And that's a free.
Yeah. Whatever question, this will be helpful to them, you know, just a response. If you have any questions or comments, that would be good. Suggestions that you've made, you take a sentence, a couple of sentences, one word, that's fine. I think it would be helpful to them to think about, you know, like some feedback.
Yeah.
You guys, have you thought of this? You know, maybe this, you know, but feel free. You know,
I just wondered if these conversations are going on other places throughout Massachusetts, throughout the country.
Well, I think what they've done is the greater Boston area. There may be some other cities lying a little bit outside of Boston. But it's Massachusetts now. I don't know what plans they have for California and the other places. But this is, and because of the performance of the play, this would be good for us now. They probably will be doing the play in other places, and then that would be the basis for that discussion. The national conversation is going on, which is good,
That organization, SEED, S-E-E-D, it's a stance, I couldn't even begin to tell you what it means. This has been going on for years, discussing these kinds of having, help bringing, so get training people to go into school systems and organizations that have these kind of dialogues.
But I think her book really just hit on very deep things, you know. I remember we heard her read it, and I remember crying at the end because there was just so much.
You know, as I said in my little thing, you know, who are these people? And it's such a powerful thing. And then the follow-up, that this thing that was making her shake, and then she goes into the hallway, and this middle-aged white woman about her age is also weeping profusely. Mm-hmm. And what was shaking this white lady up was exactly what was disturbing Claudia. And then they give it away. This is the human connection that can actually make us stay away from, because this, you choose somebody, and that's the point of saying, who are these people, P-A-E-S-E, and who are these, A-P-H-I-S, this, well, I'm not, if we essentialize each other, this is the way these people are, that's it. But the sense that there's still some hope, if, so long as you have caring individuals who understand what we are caught up in, you know, how long it would take, nobody knows. The question of making people feel good and not really making a dent now, but maybe there's still some little hope that maybe going forward, however difficult it is, maybe we win one little inch every 5 years,
right,
and another inch, another year. We don't know how long it would take, but so long as the thing is not closed now, there's the sense of finality, nothing to be hopeful again.
Right.
And then we're damned.
Focus so beautiful, but this last election was so disheartening. I felt like I left and moved to a different country, and I felt so disappointed. I think it was primarily white women who voted Trump in, and it showed me how divided we are. We can fall into a little sense of safety here in Cambridge, but then there's this whole middle of the country, you know, the east and the west coast, and then the middle of the country is different, and just having someone as destructive as Trump enabling.
Yeah, we have to, you know, we try to keep on the side and see, hopefully the politics, you know, we'll hope that people, so long as people think, and then hopefully we can, you know.
But wasn't there hope in this very most recent one when war got basically the black population is what really get it. That man didn't win, and I think that was helpful.
That guy got 68% of the white women's vote in Alabama.
Well, that's
no, but I'm talking about the he lost, but because of the black population.
Right, he lost, but he got 68% of the white female vote in Alabama.
Yeah. And
more. The one who was an admitted pedophile got 68% of
them. Yeah.
We'll try to get the rest in there. Get the discussion.
But doesn't the whole thing with women? I'm sorry, fine. Doesn't the whole thing with women and what's going on with the looking at that issue give people even more hope that there are steps being taken to get away from prejudice and discrimination, gender? I mean, I just think that people are trying.
Yeah.
To get through some of these horrible discrimination behaviors.
So there's a read more, do more list that we have a couple copies here, but it should have been emailed to you.
Yeah, I think did you guys get the email, read more, do more, the resource?
And then
maybe we can take some with you and then.
Right, and then Ifani has written also. If anybody's interested, let me know. But we did send it to you.
I don't feel like I got that.
Did it come from Grolier's bookstore?
It came from Eventbrite.
If you have some.
Yeah, we can print some of these out.
That's where the reflection on the. Well, there's an Igbo expression. I thought maybe you guys had got any, but. In West Africa, there's expression, essentially says that he who has another person pinned down to the ground is also pinning himself or herself down on the ground. I want you down so bad,
and reconvene.
I'm dying, I want you to get a cup of water, no. I want to get a book of Shakespeare's work. No, because I want you down. I stay with you. So it just seemed to be such a crazy. It's not a very intelligent ordering of our human situation.
It would take about.
I want you down. I stay with you.
Right.
I can't get up because I need some water. 15.
That's such a nice
call.
That's so much nicer. Yes.
Thank you.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you very much. It was so nice for you all to come and
Thank you.
Thank you.